Thank you so much for letting me have a few minutes in front of your distinguished audience today. Those of you who know me know that my family motto is carpe podium, but I will keep my remarks as brief as I can. After such a moving display, however, there's a couple of things that I want to make a point about as I'm introducing our distinguished keynote. You may have seen that the president is going to be putting forward a package to the Senate to move for ratification of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities. This is a long-hoped-for movement in the United States, not just in disability, but across all of the human rights activities that we really need to be stepping up now in the international community. The UN Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities includes language on technology. It includes language on families and how families are to be respected. It includes language on school and inclusion in school. It includes language on the right to community living. There is much there that we think are the principles of how we interact with folks with disabilities in the United States. Many people think that we are the world leader and that everyone just has to follow us and everything will be okay. But people who are still living in some of these institutions that the artist has identified as still operating will tell you that we have not yet accomplished the kind of world leadership that we think really needs to happen. I want to point out a little bit of technology that I find extremely useful. I carry two of these now. One is for my office, and I think of it like a small yapping dog. And then I carry this one, which is my personal one, where people can reach me, and I have all of those of you that I'm connected to in here. But I also have an app that is my favorite app, and I want to make an offer. But first, I want to let you know I have an app that is the Universal Declaration on Human Rights on my phone. Because one of the responsibilities as citizens of the world is that we are all supposed to understand the Universal Declaration on Human Rights and what it means and how we can use it in our everyday lives. When we have the arts of making and doing, that is techne, it's very important to have those be based on wisdom and knowledge and principles. And so, as we move forward to develop more and more making and doing for people with disabilities, it's very important for us to go back to these principles. It ties to our speaker today, and I'm going to explain that to you in a minute, but I just want to read Article 1. All human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. They are endowed with reason and conscience and should act toward one another in a spirit of brotherhood. I think it's important to recognize that human rights are not just the rights that we all have to be treated well by other people, but it's that we all have the right to act with conscience. We have the right to treat other people with humanity. We have the right to be fully human in ourselves. This is not easy sometimes. Sometimes the systems stand against us. Sometimes it takes a great deal of effort to act with conscience and in a spirit of brotherhood toward all other people. You've heard me say many times before that I think the Coleman and Turner families are a prime example of how we can do this in our lives and what kind of difference it can make. If you look at what we have rights to, we have in as people with disabilities and their families, we often think about the right to remedy. The right to remedy in school, the right to remedy in healthcare, the right to remedy in many places. Remedy is dangerous. We just lost one of our tremendous advocates in the disability field, Paul Miller, died on Tuesday morning. Paul wrote a brilliant paper about genomics and how there is a danger that the technology of genomics will turn into genocide for people with disabilities. It's important for us to keep that in mind as we move forward. We also know that we have the right to rehab. We have the right to accommodations. Many of us have tools that we use and carry around and depend on. Getting those technologies, the rehab technologies, into people's lives are sometimes difficult. As Peter Blank said to me a few minutes ago, you know, getting the Medicaid rules to apply to allow you to acquire the technologies that you need is not always easy to do. Apps are technologies. I also have an IEP checklist on my iPhone. And here's the offer I want to make. If anybody wants to do an app on the Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities, drop me a line at NIDER, sue.swenson@ed.gov, and I'll see if I can find a way to pay you for it. Mm-hmm. Rights are not something that just fall on you out of the sky. If you don't carry them around, either in your iPhone or in your heart, you don't have them. You think that rights are something that everyone else owes you, but in fact, as we know in the disability movement, it's our ability to express and demand our rights that makes the biggest difference. And so it's important to recognize, how many ways can we help people understand their rights? That's why an app for the Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities would be so useful. For that matter, an app on the ADA would be useful. The United States International Council on Disability is doing a very interesting technology project where they have something called the web in a box. Don't ask me how they do this, but they basically take everything about disability and disability rights and put it in a hard drive that they can take to parts of the world where there is no internet access at all. And okay, so maybe we're hoping that someday there will be internet access, but those people's lives are proceeding even today, even yesterday, and they do need to know about their rights. And that's a very interesting use of technology to think about doing that. Now, the last right that the UN Declaration gives us that I think that the Universal Declaration on Human Rights gives us that I think we really need to think about is the right to revolution. Each of us in our lives has the right. And it's expressed as we have to recognize each other's human rights so that there will not be rebellion and war. But we also have the right, fully expressed in the Declaration, to social and cultural revolution in our lives. This is how we avoid political and military revolution. When we look around and say, you know what, we need more equity, we need more freedom, we need to reach out to people who have been exiled within our own country, and we need to make sure that that never happens again. Now here's the connection to Tom Gilhool. The Universal Declaration on Human Rights was written with a great deal of input from early parent leaders of the ARC. Gunnar Du Bois, and even before him, the UN sent people to the United States to study what happened when you institutionalized people and why did all these families think that it was such a bad idea. Now, the Coleman Center on Cognitive and Intellectual Disabilities, sometimes people in the disability world think that those of us who are in that world of cognitive and intellectual disabilities are on the bottom rung of the ladder. They treat us as if, well, when we're done getting rights for everyone else, we'll get to you. But I really want to point out that it was people with cognitive and intellectual disabilities and their families who led the demand for human rights and for rights all throughout history. And we need to take that piece of our history and hold it tight. Mr. Gilhool will explain to you that it was the parents of the Pennsylvania Association for Retarded Children, at the time that was what it was called, who brought a suit that said, the people who live in Pennhurst have a right to a free and appropriate public education, and the institution should be closed, and the people, all of the children, have a right to an education. 1.8 million children in the United States were not in school, or were in schools that were run by their parents, outside of the system. Or they were living in these places that you just saw. Which, by the way, I don't know how you took it, but I felt a little surge of happiness whenever I saw the line closed on the picture. And then I felt this extreme need to remember the accumulation of misery in these empty places, and how miserable it must have been to be a child and be taken from your family and put in a place and not educated and not given clothes that were your own to wear and not allowed to have any freedom in your life at all. Now, Tom Gilhool started out doing public interest law. I think you were almost 30 years at the Public Interest Law Center in Philadelphia. Was one of the founders of the disability law movement in the United States. Was a hero of Sergeant Shriver's. I don't know if you knew that, but he told me that multiple times. And brought the Park case that turned into not only IDEA, but turned into 503, 504, and 508 in the Voc Rehab Act. And has done a significant amount of international work, including a Fulbright Fellowship in Japan, working to help ensure that across national boundaries we can cooperate with each other. This, I believe, is the big plus of the Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities. It brings us the responsibility as U.S. nonprofits to interact with other nonprofits around the world in civil society to create a better foundation of knowledge and wisdom and principles for our for our technology. And so it is with great pleasure that I introduce Tom Gilhool.
You may remember from fifth grade or ninth grade or 11th grade history that the first great decision of the United States Supreme Court was written by Chief Justice Marshall in Marbury versus Madison in 1803. It was in that case that Sue's right to remedy was declared. Under our constitutional system, Marshall wrote, there is no constitutional wrong without a remedy. We have, all of us, been lucky to live in a time when that has been widely expected by the American people, and in a time when the court believed and acted that its job was to enforce the Constitution and laws of the United States. That time has been in disrepute since the 1980s. The Rehnquist Court, beginning with the Developmental Disabilities Bill of Rights and Services Act in 1981, refused to enforce three dozen acts of Congress, including the Safe Schools and Communities, Safe Schools, Safe and Drug-Free Schools and Communities Act, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, several gender rights acts. The Roberts administration shows thus far no sign of returning us to Chief Justice Marshall's understanding of the Constitution. We are not the leader in the world in the reality of disability rights. The Scandinavian countries and Holland are, of course, as those of you who have read the famous Stieg Larsson trilogy know, that is one of, that is how, that is one way that a fully realized person with autism may look like. The heroine of that trilogy. I am pleased and honored to deliver the morning keynote at this 10th annual conversation of the Coleman Institute. And to mark the accomplishments of the two institutions, I will call them systems, which David Braddock has founded. The information system, clear, straightforward, unimpeachable, upon which all of us have been able to act. And with Bill and Claudia Coleman and Suzanne Turner, this Coleman Institute, which promises to bring a new sense of what life can be. I'm pleased to deliver the keynote, especially to celebrate the 40th anniversary of the remarkable undertaking of the Pennsylvania Association for Retarded Citizens, as it was then called, and to celebrate the remarkable courage and insight of the people who were and are the Pennsylvania Association, now ARC of Pennsylvania. To celebrate just a bit early the 35th anniversary of the enactment by Congress of the Education for All Handicapped Children's Act of 1975. And to celebrate again the great capabilities of people with disability, and to resolve again with you that they will be one day realized fully. My remarks may be called tales of equality, recent, current, future. Tales of possibilities, achieved, struggled for still, and just barely glimpsed, but full of profound moment for all people, including all people with disabilities. I have a lot of ground that I want to cover with you. I'm going to talk as fast as I possibly can, and I'm asking you to listen fast. And I ask you also to draw in your own mind the parallels suggested by the right to education and the right to community living for the creation of a right to fully accessible technology. I would like to start with with the earliest thing I learned about law and technology. 49 years ago this fall at the Yale Law School, in a first year course, a small group seminar, it may not surprise you, in torts. Torts concern the duties of care which people owe to one another, and which aggregations created by people, corporations, companies, so on, owe to people. You may know torts by a different language, given the devalued public discourse of recent decades. You may know torts as about greedy lawyers, uninjured plaintiffs, accidents that were negligible, and astonishing awards of penal damages. It's accident law. Learned Hand, in 1928, a great judge of the United States Court of Appeals for the Second Circuit, sitting in New York, in a case called In Re T.J. Hooper, spoke to us
to our work.
T.J. Hooper was a tugboat. It had sunk in the waters off New York. At that time, the common way to warn a tugboat of an oncoming severe storm were hand signals from the shore. Radio had been invented, but it was used by just a few tugboat operators. The question in the case was, what is the duty of care owed by a tugboat company and operator to those who have entrusted their lives or significant amounts of their property to the tugboat? Learned Hand's answer was that the standard of care, the duty of care, was not the standard of the practice, but it was the state of the art. If it can be done, the common law of tort requires, at pain of penalty, that it be done. The second important learning that contributes to what the main tale that I will tell came from a friend of this Bill Coleman, also named Bill Coleman, William Thaddeus Coleman, Jr., the Thaddeus after his father, from Thaddeus Stevens, the primary author of the 13th and the 14th Amendments. I practiced law at the Dilworth firm for a year and a half at the start. Bill Coleman taught me how to practice. The first case which I pleaded and which he led was the Girard College case. The question was whether Stephen Girard's will, which in 1842 established a superb high school for poor white male orphans, should remain white. I learned that the dead hand of the past can be raised by the 14th Amendment. The third of my early learnings. I was, as Sue noted, a member of the first generation of Office of Economic Opportunity Legal Services lawyers. I did not know of Sargent's sense of me. I served on his National Advisory Committee, and I chaired the Law Reform Committee, Advisory Committee of the lawyers, the legal services lawyers in the country. We resolved to use the courts, but we resolved something else that is characteristic of our disability movement. We resolved that we would have real clients. And we resolved that we would listen to and hear those clients. And we resolved that it was a very important part of our responsibility as lawyers to contribute to the strength of the organizations of our clients and to contribute whatever the law could contribute to their actions in all forums, whether in the Denver streets in wheelchairs, not letting the buses, the inaccessible buses, move, whether in the Congress in pursuit of the 21st Century Communication and Video Accessibility Act, wherever. The second thing that we learned in the courts and from the Supreme Court of that time, and from our clients, for not a single legal services case went to court without having benefited from the experience and the explicit advice of what the law should be and even how it is we should reason to get it from a judge, from our clients. There was then something called the New Equal Protection. It was celebrated by our clients. It was acted upon in the legal services program. It was significantly ratified by the United States Supreme Court. I was happy enough, fortunate enough, with my clients, and they came to the Supreme Court in Washington for the argument of the first legal services case to be argued there, Shapiro versus Thompson. I was raised and educated in parochial schools, and therefore I have great inclinations of deference to authority. For me, I discovered early it was crucial in front of any court, let alone the high court, that my client should be in the courtroom so that I could remind myself that it was their case I was pleading, not mine. In a series of cases called welfare cases, public housing cases, a particular variety of education case, the Supreme Court in essence said, its first articulation, though it has bubbled throughout our history, the Supreme Court, in essence, said that when important matters are at stake, a bit like the T.J. Hooper, when important matters are at stake, income, housing, schooling, food, nutrition, as we would say now, the 14th Amendment requires that we look very carefully at any action which excludes people from a decent income, decent housing, decent schooling, decent food and nutrition. The first clause of the 14th Amendment is the Equal Citizenship Clause. It's in the second clause that the Equal Protection and Due Process clauses, quite different, are contained. My very favorite articulation of what it is, the 14th Amendment Equal Citizenship requires, is Ken Karst, offered in the preface to a particular year of the Supreme Court in the Harvard Law Review in the 1970s. And it says well what the courts then, but less and less now until we renew them, was equal citizenship. The principle of equal citizenship, Karst writes, presumptively insists that the organized society treat each individual as a person, one who is worthy of respect, one who belongs. Stated negatively, the principle presumptively forbids the organized society to treat an individual either as a member of an inferior or dependent caste or as a non-participant. As Skelly Wright, a great judge, originally in the South on the Court of Appeals Federal, moved to his pleasure and relief, for it was dangerous for judges in the South in the 60s, to the District of Columbia Court of Appeals, found there similar conditions presented to him in cases, and it was he who said, The 14th Amendment, at core, prohibits the arbitrary quality of thoughtlessness. In other words, where important matters are at stake, the common law requires the use of the state of the art. Where important matters are at stake, the Constitution, the 14th Amendment in particular, requires thoughtfulness and thoughtful and full inclusion. The leadership of the Pennsylvania Association for Retarded Children came to my office in 1969 when I had returned after several years at Legal Services briefly to the Dilworth office. They had just conducted their most recent investigation of Pennhurst, Pennsylvania's flagship institution, created by the legislature in 1913 explicitly to segregate the epileptic, idiotic, and feeble-minded. Their investigation of Pennhurst found life there nasty, brutish, and short. They resolved that their purpose, henceforth, would be to end the institution and to open the community. I can't fail to tell you of a visit to the Pennhurst Institution, closed at this time some 30 years, by a delegation from Japan, from People First, and from the Japan Federation of Bar Associations Human Rights Committee for People with Disabilities, just 2 years ago. We entered a building that looked exactly like, cut from the same cloth, as the building you saw from Norfolk, Nebraska's institution. The double metal doors were open. Someone had written in bold red paint, "Niggers," with an arrow pointing in, betraying a considerable notion of the history of the origin of the discrimination against people with disability and the creation of these segregating and isolating institutions. There was a sign next to the door warning of the stuff that was in walls that kills people?
Asbestos.
A sign that was not there while Pennhurst was open, but a sign that went up after it closed. Inside, we found, you've seen it, in the debris of the restraining instruments of the institution, we found a hat with a very large brim in the middle of the floor. And one couldn't help but see in one's mind's eye the last person at Pennhurst, ready to leave, and leaving with a hurrah and a toss of his hat into the air. How, you may wonder, did the park membership and leadership get from resolving to end the institutions to resolving to go to court seeking the right to education, seeking to open the schools to people with disability? The answer will immediately occur to you. As the work of the President's Committee on Mental Retardation, published as early as 67, showed, overwhelmingly, people went to institutions when they were 12, 13, or 14. at the age when they began to reach out to take control of their world, as all early teenagers do. And when, without the solace, the support, even the time off, let alone the learning from attendance by their children at schools, parents turned to the only thing available, the institutions. Park's theory was that if the schools were open, the institutions would close, and indeed it was so. In 1970, some 1,500 people of school age, those ages, were admitted to institutions in the United States. Forgive me, 15,000. By 1981, 3 years after the full implementation of Public Law 94-142, only 1,500 were. And since, with the exception of some very few, very bad states, no children of school age have gone to institutions year after year after year. There was another reason why Park chose to begin with the right to education. Having chosen to borrow a leaf from the civil rights movement race by turning to the courts, they understood that what one does with courts is teach them. The courts, since Brown versus Board of Education, had learned much about the schools. They knew nothing of institutions. They knew nothing of retardation. And so, by starting with the education case, we didn't have to teach the courts two things, but one. There was finally another reason. It was a reason that Gunnar Dibwad, the great man, early National Executive Director of the National Association for Retarded Children, professor at Brandeis University, and counselor to the movement as a whole, the ARCs in particular, and among the patron saints of People First organizations and its movement. As Gunnar Dibwad had noticed rather early, Brown versus Board of Education provided to people with disability in their childhood a constitutional opportunity. In Brown, the court wrote, "Today, education is perhaps the most important function of state and local governments. Compulsory school attendance and the great expenditures for education demonstrate our recognition of the importance of education to our democratic society. It is required in the performance of our most basic public responsibilities, even service in the armed forces. It is the very foundation of good citizenship. Today, it is a principal instrument in awakening the child to cultural values, in preparing him for later training, and in helping him to adjust normally to his environment. In these days, it is doubtful that any child may reasonably be expected to succeed in life if he is denied the opportunity of an education. Such an opportunity, where the state has undertaken to provide it to some, is a right which must be made available to all on equal terms." So we stood on strong constitutional ground to ask the courts to open the schools to children with disabilities. Understand, the equality the court spoke of, the equality of our tradition, is not geometrical equality. It's not mere formal equality, but it is real functional equality. We learned much later, I am embarrassed to say, that John W. Davis, who argued Brown versus Board of Education for the defendant state of South Carolina, himself the Democratic candidate for president after 124 ballots in 1924, himself three times declined appointment to the United States Supreme Court, himself a president of the American Bar Association, Solicitor General of the United States for Woodrow Wilson in the early teens, and the most respected appellate advocate of his time. John W. Davis opened his argument to the court in Brown by saying, "May it please the court, I think if the plaintiff children's construction of the 14th Amendment should prevail here, I am unable to see why a state would have any further right to segregate on the ground of gender or on the ground of age or on the ground of mental capacity." It wasn't a stretch for John W. Davis in his late 70s, early 80s, to make that argument. For he was a person of his generation. In 1899, the Committee on Colonies for the Segregation of Mental Defectives recommended to the convention of the National Conference on Charities and Corrections, having noted that public funds were flowing at a great rate to institutions for the mentally ill, that the conference should persuade the people of the country that the mentally retarded were also very dangerous. In virtually every state in the nation, in Pennsylvania, it was in advance of the creation of Pennhurst in 1913, the state chapter of the Conferences on Charities and Corrections, led almost always by the figures from the leading families of the states, published pamphlets. Thomas Paine was still within memory, and pamphlets were a mode of public discourse as late as then. In Pennsylvania, the pamphlet was called "The Menace of the Feeble-Minded in Pennsylvania." Connecticut's pamphlet in 1915 had the same title. Ohio, "The Feeble-Minded, the Hub to Our Wheel of Vice." Martin Barr, the president of the Association of Superintendents of Medical Officers for Institutions for the Idiotic and Feeble-Minded Persons, the direct predecessor of Michael and Maggie, the president currently of the association we know and love as the American Association for Intellectually and Cognitively Disabled, an organization redeemed by the superintendents of mental retardation institutions in the 1960s and 70s when these battles raged, led by Jim Clements, superintendent of Georgia's most notorious institution, were crucial to our success, for they told the truth on the stand, both about what the institutions were and about what the capabilities of people with retardation consigned there for living and contributing to community were. He took issue with an earlier Massachusettsan, whose name all of you can name and I can't call back to my mind right now, who in the middle of the 19th century had seen, as most had, these what became institutions as schools, residential schools, where people came and learned and returned shortly to their community to live and work. And Martin Barr said, "That good doctor wrote before the tide of immigration had set so strongly to our shores. What is to be done with the feeble-minded progeny of the foreign hordes that have settled and are settling among us?" Indeed, in 1913, H.H. Goddard, the author of the Kallikak family, the superintendent of the famous then public, later private institution in New Jersey, had, at the request of the United States Public Health Service, administered Binet's then new IQ test to the Southern and Eastern European immigrants arriving in steerage at Ellis Island. He found, giving the immigrant the benefit of every doubt, 79% of the Italians, 80% of the Hungarians, 83% of the Jews, and 87% of the Russians were feeble-minded. The Irish and the Germans escaped because we had come some time ago, sometime before all of that. Another observer of this turn into the century said, "These institutions partake of the industrial and manual training given in the antebellum days on the plantation, which were in fact, as the world is fast acknowledging, training schools for a backward race, the plantations, many of whom were feeble-minded." Thurgood Marshall, in the first equal protection case concerning retardation to reach the Supreme Court in modern times, there were others earlier in this same xenophobic era, City of Cleburne, Texas versus Cleburne Living Center, described, and I quote, the 20th century Marshall, the lengthy and tragic history of segregation and discrimination experienced by people with retardation can only be called grotesque. A regime of state-mandated segregation and degradation emerged at the turn from the 19th into the 20th century that in its virulence and bigotry rivaled and indeed paralleled the worst excesses of Jim Crow. Massive custodial institutions were built to warehouse the retarded for life. The aim was to halt reproduction of the retarded and nearly extinguish their race, a quote from an act of the legislature of one state. Retarded children were categorically excluded from public schools based on the false stereotype that all were ineducable and on the purported need to protect non-retarded children from them. Prejudice, once let loose, is not easily cabined. lengthy and continuing isolation of the retarded has perpetuated the ignorance, irrational fears, and stereotyping that long have plagued them. This was the world of people with retardation and their families, their extended families. We used to say to the Congress, for every retarded person, there are 10 voters in the extended family to whom this person and this person's welfare is dear. The same measure is roughly right for those who find it important and necessary to calculate the market before engaging in creative technology and marketing it. This was the world until the disability rights movement resolved and persistently acted with courage and insight to change it. In those actions, the interaction between the laws of the nation enacted by Congress and the law and constitution of the nation declared by the courts have importantly interacted. Prior to the trial of the Park case in 1971, there had been a few acts of the 50s and a few of 1963 which provided funds for training teachers and others. There were acts creating the Assistant Commissionership of Education for the education of children with disabilities, and so on. The trial of the Park case was shaped by the history and by the new possibility, the new possibilities, the newly recognized possibilities of people with retardation. The first witness was Ignacy Goldberg of Columbia Teachers College, who, at the request of the American Legion, had traveled state legislatures of the country, asking them to open classes for the trainable mentally retarded. He told the court of the history of which I have spoken and the history which you know. The second and third witnesses were Jim Gallagher, who was the first Deputy Commissioner of Education for the Education of Children with Disability, and Don Steadman, both then at the University of North Carolina, Don, a predecessor of Sue's at the Kennedy Foundation, who spoke to the state of the art, who testified as the Council for Exceptional Children, the professional organization of teachers, had declared just a few years before, who spoke to the fact that every child can learn. It was Plato's theory of knowledge in some sense. You know, we are all born with all knowledge in our head. The trick for teachers and families is to ask the right questions to bring it forward. And the last witness was Burton Blatt, spoken of yesterday. Not so much about Christmas in Purgatory as about his PhD dissertation, which had been about the changeability of intelligence. At the close of that testimony, in front of the three-judge court, one of them, a former lieutenant governor of Pennsylvania, the other a former Secretary of Public Welfare of Pennsylvania, the third a former member of the school board of the city of Philadelphia. A different stripe of judge, you will notice, than the stripe of judge we have become used to. These were, as I wryly said in a paper to the American Association of Law Schools some time ago, these were failed politicians. And as such, two things were true of them. As lieutenant governor, but never governor, as secretary of welfare, but never more, and so on. They understood how complex public and private institutions worked. They could see how a change of rule or law would work its way through those institutions in the lives of the people who had brought the case before them. And as I wryly concluded, they were different in another way too. They took constitutionalized values more seriously, perhaps, than the successful politicians. The court gave the parties the opportunity to write the orders that would implement the right to education. The court, just about now, in October of 1971, issued those orders for the court. That case was followed by one in the District of Columbia, by the third in Louisiana, New Orleans, by 30 more across the state, all of which reached the same conclusion and entered similar judicial orders. Within 6 months of the Park Decree, the Congress, a bipartisan couple in each house, Percy of Illinois and Humphrey of Minnesota in the Senate, and John Bradamus and a sainted congressman from Tennessee in the House, had introduced what became Section 504, the first Civil Rights Act, which adopted the language of the Civil Rights Acts concerned with race and concerned with gender, and which provided that no person shall be excluded from participation in, denied the benefit of, or otherwise discriminated against in any program receiving federal financial assistance. Within 3 years, the Congress had adopted the Education for All Handicapped Children's Act. Now, what was this 14th Amendment that caused all of this turnabout? Revolution, in Jefferson's terms. A new beginning, as he put it, required of us as citizens of this country every 20 years. What was it? It was the fundamental commitment to the proposition of equality, first articulated by Jefferson, writing in the upper room at 7th and High Street in Philadelphia. The richness of what Jefferson understood by the commitment to equality was suggested by the other thing he wrote during those same weeks in Philadelphia. It was his three drafts of the Constitution, of a Constitution for the now to be about, you know, Virginia. For all of us who sometimes temporize, it is perhaps some comfort that Jefferson did not get his third draft to Williamsburg early enough to be fully considered and adopted. But it tells us what he thought the fundamental commitment to equality encompassed. He provided in his Bill of Rights for the Virginia Constitution that no person thereafter entering into Virginia should be held in slavery. He provided that daughters should hereafter inherit on the same basis as sons. And he provided in the first provision of his Bill of Rights that to every person in Virginia who had no land should go from the king's land 50 acres, and to those who had some but not 50 acres, enough to make up 50 acres. Alexis de Tocqueville in 1831, in the author's preface to the two-volume Democracy in America, wrote, "Nothing so distinguishes the United States from all of the other countries of the world as its equality of condition." Political equality, yes. Economic equality, yes. Social equality, yes. Abraham Lincoln, in what is called his Dred Scott speech, delivered in Springfield in 1857, wrote, "The assertion that all men are created equal was of no practical use in effecting our separation from Great Britain. And it was placed in the Declaration not for that, but for its future use. They meant to set up a standard maxim for a free society which should be familiar to all and revered by all, constantly looked to, constantly labored for, and even though never perfectly attained, constantly approximated, and thereby constantly spreading and deepening its influence and augmenting the happiness and value of life to all people everywhere." They meant simply to declare the right so that enforcement of it might follow as fast as circumstances should permit. Well, by the turn into the 70s, circumstances did permit. By the turn out of the 70s, circumstances allowed us to demonstrate to the court that for every person at the Pennhurst Institution, there was one or two or three disability twins, functional twins. Similar configuration of disability, similar number of years in the institution, and so on. Living happily, participating, some even in that glorious day with jobs, bigger problem now, in the community. It was called the Twin Study, and it was presented to the court by the chairman of the Statistics Department of Temple University, later a professor at this institution associated with the NASA Statistical Center that was here. The court heard 13 expert witnesses, including superintendents, including an Englishman, the head of the United Cerebral Palsy Association of England, who in many different languages demonstrated to the court that there were no exceptions, that all could benefit. And so the court entered the first set of orders based in the equality clauses of the 14th Amendment, requiring that the institution be taken down and community services be built. I hope your mind has been working on the analogies to the right to accessible technology that we are about thinking how to and then acting to create in the courts and in the legislature. Brown's articulation of the central nature of schools, which required with the 14th Amendment that they be open to all, is easily articulated, is it not, with respect to the technologies that have exploded in recent decades and that will define life for all of our people, and hence must define life for people with disabilities as well. You can each write the paragraph about the central nature of these technologies to all of us and to people with disability. Think of the social networks that become possible when the technology is accessible to all people with retardation. Think of the jobs that become real when the technology that dominates the workplace, the technologies, are accessible to all people with disability. There's an easy way to close, and it is to return to Lincoln. For those of you in this room, the scientists, the engineers, the entrepreneurs, the inventors, the members and leaders of the movement for the freedom and full realization of the capabilities of people with disability, you, as Lincoln said, have it within the power of your imagination and your bold and courageous action to create the circumstances which will now permit the constitutional requirement of a decent equality and access, as others, functionally as good as others, to these defining technologies. That's our job. The Coleman Institute informs, stimulates, and inspires us in that job. And for that, I thank them, and I thank you.